Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Once Around the Track by Sharyn McCrumb, narrated by Nicole Poole and directed by Jeremy M. Brewer. This book is copyrighted 2007 by Sharyn McCrumb. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. Racing fans have never seen anything like it, and they've seen plenty. From daredevil drivers, to fiery crashes, to victory laps that bring tears to grown men's eyes. But this is something altogether different. This is the first all-women's team in stock car racing history. And now, Once Around the Track.
Chapter 1. Once Removed. Have you found him yet? The voice on the cell phone was shrill and insistent, but then it always was, even for the most trivial of messages. Clients were notoriously impatient people, and she billed them accordingly. Susie Terrell looked out her windshield at the kudzu-covered hillside, overlooking a ramshackle collection of buildings that could hardly be called a town. Next to the narrow concrete bridge, spanning what was surely nothing more than a creek, was a battered tin sign, emblazoned with checkered flags and bearing the bullet-riddled legend, Marengo, Georgia, home of Badger Jenkins, winner of the Southern 500. I think I'm on the last lap, she said warily, and clicked off the phone. As an Atlanta lawyer, Susie Terrell had had her share of bizarre commissions. Suing the dog's plastic surgeon came to mind, and this latest directive from a group of women investors would probably make the short list of stories to tell at dinner parties after four drinks. It promised to be quite an adventure. Find Badger Jenkins. Who the hell? When she received the assignment, she had dutifully looked him up on the internet, and an instant later, the name appeared on her computer screen, accompanied by an image of a glowering but handsome man in opaque black sunglasses and a red and black fire suit, positively robotic in his well-chiseled perfection, possessing all the soulless beauty of a state-of-the-art espresso machine. She stared at the scowling face for a few moments. Then she sank back in her office chair and muttered to herself, "Oh, great. Now I have to go and make small talk with the Angel of Death." Further searches on the internet turned up only vague hints as to the current whereabouts of this alien being. Badger Jenkins, it turned out, was a race car driver, currently unemployed and a little older than NASCAR's current crop of drivers. That is, he was old enough to shave. He was a native Georgian. He had won a few races, raised his share of hell both on and off the track, and was thought to be back home in some one-horse town called Marengo, wherever that was. What Mr. Jenkins was doing these days was anybody's guess. Susie had tried calling his business office in Marengo, but there didn't seem to be one. The phone number, garnered from an out-of-date website, turned out to be located in the Blue Tick Cafe, and was answered by a drawling waitress named Lorraine, who claimed to be Badger Jenkins' second cousin once removed.
Once removed? Said Susie.
Yeah, hon. Once removed out from under him in the back seat of his car by my daddy in a loaded shotgun. I got grounded for 3 months, but boy, it was worth it. He wasn't but 17 himself that time.
She sighed, savoring the moment.
Old Badger was hotter than a $2 pistol back then. Tearing up dirt tracks, leaving a trail of broken hearts and dented fenders. Face like an angel and hell on wheels. You ever seen one of them early sports cards of him?
No.
Woohoo! It'd give you hot flashes just to look at him. There's one of them cards I kept to this day that shows him with his fire suit unzipped to where you can see his curly little chest hair peeping out, and those white pants so tight you could practically read the Trojan wrapper in his pocket. Of course, that fire suit didn't have pockets, as I recall, but you get my drift. and him sitting there grinning and facing the camera with his legs spread eagled wide apart, same as he sits in every picture I have ever seen of him right to this day. Like show and tell, I swear, try as you might, you can't help but look. Honey, if that boy was a mind reader, he could not walk past a crowd of women without limping. How evocative, Susie shuddered. Perhaps you can help me. I am trying to locate Mr. Jenkins. I was hoping that you could tell me how to reach him. Lorraine was silent for a few moments. Then she said, Well, your best bet is the post office box. I think the rent on it is paid up anyhow. Course, even if it isn't, Ms. Todd Hunter, the postmistress, will give him the letters anyhow. She's 70 if she's a minute, but she looks at him like a stray dog eyeing a drumstick. Perhaps there is a phone number where he could be reached?
Oh, he don't like us to give out phone numbers, especially to bill collectors or ladies of a certain age, if you know what I'm saying. Badger says he's a race car driver, not a damn turkey baster.
I have a business proposition to discuss with Mr. Jenkins, said Susie, adding ice to her most lawyerly tone.
Oh, well, I reckon you can talk to his daddy then. That might get a message to him. Mr. Jenkins says he don't care if I give out his number to the older ladies. Reckon he's hoping he'll get some of the overflow.
But that hadn't gone well either. The old man who answered the phone had barely let her say her name before he launched into his spiel.
If you're calling about Cloverhoof, our prize Angus bull, why, his stud fee is $500 payable in advance. He is a champion. He is wonder.
No, sir, it's not about the bull.
Well, now, Keeper, our coonhound, ain't won no prizes, but he's the best tracker in three counties, no argument there, and his stud fee is $50, cash money, and the pick of the litter.
Mr. Jenkins, I'm calling about your son Badger.
Oh. Well, I reckon you'd better talk to him directly then, said the old man. I don't know what he charges.
In the end, Susie consulted a road atlas, left her office in Atlanta, and drove nearly 3 hours north into the red clay hills of Georgia in search of Marengo, which Lorraine had assured her was so small it was only on the map 2 days a week. Now she had found it. Parking wasn't a problem, she told herself, as she surveyed the block of gently decaying storefronts subsiding into the hill of kudzu behind it. She seemed to be the only person in town. The two-lane blacktop was devoid of traffic, and the town's one stoplight was permanently set on a yellow caution light. In the minute business district, consisting of mostly empty buildings, the Blue Tick Cafe was easy enough to spot. A whitewashed cinder block building with a big plate glass window framed by two white flower boxes of red geraniums. Susie surveyed the scene, looking for stray dogs. In case she had to order something in the diner, she could always eat the pickle, ask for the rest of the order to go, and then give it to some starving pooch with a cast iron stomach. Assuming her brightest junior league smile, the one that said my teeth and my pearls are both real, Susie Terrell stepped inside the cafe and beamed at the dishwater blonde behind the counter. Are you Lorraine? We spoke on the phone. Narrowed eyes took in her pastel blue silk suit from Neiman Marcus and her Dolce & Gabbana purse.
Yeah, I remember.
Is this about Badger?
Yes, it is. I represent a group of women.
The waitress rolled her eyes and heaved a theatrical sigh.
His DNA is on file at the courthouse.
No, that isn't it. My clients want to offer him a job. Driving a cup car.
A cup car. 3 weeks ago,
That term would have mystified her, ignorant as she was of all things NASCAR. Just because you were born and bred in Atlanta didn't mean you acquired knowledge of stock car racing by osmosis. After all, what they called the Atlanta Motor Speedway was, in fact, in Hampton, Georgia, some 30 miles south of the big city. Susie Terrell had never been there. In fact, where stock car racing was concerned, she had cherished her ignorance. Now, here she was in an even more remote and savage place, Marengo, Georgia, teetering on the edge of the world, awaiting the arrival of the town's one celebrity, Badger Jenkins, race car driver and local satyr. She cast about in search of small talk that she could make with the creature when he did appear, but quickly abandoned that idea. After all, how many one-syllable words could you string together? Maybe it would be better just to get right down to business. A group of female investors in Atlanta has secured funding, and God knows why. They wanted to field a NASCAR team with an all-female crew, except for the driver, because there are no women drivers at cup level, the major league of motorsports. And they had chosen Badger Jenkins as their designated driver. Oh well, she supposed that if the genders were reversed, no one would question the logic of their choice. Why not get a pretty one? That had been the underlying theme of male employment criteria for millennia. And if those sports cards were any indication, Badger Jenkins certainly was a pretty one. His face was a perfect intersection of lines and planes, the straight nose, the cleft chin, eyes the brown of Colombian coffee. The better to drown you in, my dear. Ancient eyes that seemed to hold the sorrows of the world. Saints' eyes. Oh, Badger Jenkins had won the gene pool, all right. In those beautiful eyes, it would be easy to read complexity and depth where none might exist. To build him a soul and then proceed to fall in love with it. The oldest of biological traps. That was exactly why pretty wasn't a safe commodity. Pretty is coral snakes and lightning bolts and the elegant spirals of plague DNA. She thought that to see such perfection in a human figure ought to trigger a signal in your brain that said, run! Well, Susie told herself, she was only the attorney for the business deal. She wouldn't have to work with him. All she had to do was make him an offer on behalf of her clients. So what if he was handsome? He probably had an IQ of room temperature and the ego of a Turkish sultan. Spending an hour in conversation with this warrior angel would give her a tale to dine out on in the party circuit for months to come. Since she had to talk to him, she might as well enjoy it. She had managed to impress Lorraine with the magnitude of the offer to Badger, the possibility of another chance to drive in NASCAR, and, with some misgivings, the waitress had agreed to phone the news to Badger himself, assuming that his cell phone got any reception out there on the lake. Susie accepted a cup of coffee and a week-old copy of the Marengo Herald and sat down in a booth to await further developments. After a few minutes of muffled conversation, Lorraine announced that Badger himself would be along directly, which in the South could mean anything from 5 minutes to an hour and a half. Susie nodded and continued to study the Vidalia onion recipes on page 6 of the paper. She sipped her coffee and wondered what Badger Jenkins would be having to drink if he did show up. From the look of that menacing photo of him on the website, his drink of choice would be vodka and kerosene. She didn't see it on the beverage menu. Directly translated to 18 minutes and one free refill of black coffee before she heard a soft, drawling voice say, "I understand you're looking for me." Slowly,
She lowered the newspaper and kept lowering it.
The angel of death had apparently sent a cherub in his place.
This boy, well, maybe not a boy exactly, he wasn't very tall, but apparently he was as tall as he was going to get because there were touches of gray in his brown hair. Was he 35? 40, maybe?
She looked into a pair of dark, earnest eyes that made her think that if the werewolf legend ever worked in reverse so that a golden retriever could become human, he would look just like this sweet-faced boy. Slender, handsome, and deeply sincere. In faded jeans, old work boots, and a t-shirt too worn for the logo to be legible, he stood there, as solemn as a guide dog, waiting to hear how he might help the lady.
Was this Badger's younger brother, she wondered? His son, even?
How do you do? Said Susie, gearing up to convince yet another Marengo resident that she needed to see their local legend in person. I am hoping to meet Badger Jenkins.
Solemnly, the were-retriever offered her his paw, or his hand, and said, Yes, ma'am, I'm him.
No way! She turned her exclamation of astonishment into a discreet cough as she struggled to regain her professional composure. Now that she looked at him, she could see the resemblance between that fine-featured human face and the symphony of lines and planes that had been transformed into machine-like perfection in the motorsports publicity photos. Amazing what sports cards could imply without actually coming right out and saying it. The scowling 6-foot angel of death, who looked like he ate kittens for breakfast, was apparently just a well-crafted media image of this angelic-looking kid from the backwoods of Georgia, who looked perfectly capable of giving his own breakfast to those aforementioned kittens. Go figure. He nodded, still looking serious and deeply sincere, as if worried that his ordinariness had distressed her. She motioned for him to take a seat opposite her in the booth.
I am Suzanne Terrell. I'm from a law firm in Atlanta, and I'm here on behalf of a group of investors to offer you a proposition.
Business proposition, she corrected herself silently. Business proposition, she sighed. Watch him pounce on that with a leering grin. But he was still looking at her with that earnest, faintly worried retriever expression, without a flicker of amusement.
Yes, ma'am?
She stared into his sorrowful brown eyes, searching for some trace of irony or opportunism. But if it was there, it was masquerading as polite sincerity. Boy, he's good, she thought. He almost has me fooled. And he has the most perfect, regular features. The camera would love him. You could probably sell beachfront property in Kansas with that seraphic face. She kept staring at him for just a few beats too long before some still-functioning part of her brain called the rest of her body to order, prompting her to return to the business at hand.
The people who sent me want to form an all-female NASCAR team, she said. Well, except for the driver, because there aren't any women drivers in cup racing, or so they tell me. So they need one Y chromosome to round out the team, and they want it to be yours.
Badger Jenkins' brow furrowed.
What's that mean?
What?
That Y thing.
Ah, chromosome. It means they need a man to drive the car.
Oh. But the rest of the team will be women? He considered it.
Have to be some big ones, then. Some of those pit jobs, like gassing and jacking, call for right much size and strength, you know.
Susie didn't know, but she assumed that the people with the $20 million had taken such things into account.
"Well, this is all preliminary," she told him. "They just wanted to talk to you, to see if you're interested."
Badger Jenkins glanced at his watch. "Well, it might be," he said, "if it isn't a POS car."
"I believe it is a standard stock car," said Susie. "A Ford, perhaps, or a Dodge."
Lorraine, who had been hovering in the background, coffee pot in hand, giggled.
"POS means piece of shit," she announced.
"That was the problem with his last team, wasn't it, hon? They had an underfunded POS car, and they wanted him to stand on it, and of course he wouldn't. Been crazy to have."
Susie blinked. Apparently, when one comes to North Georgia, one should bring along an interpreter. Well, whatever all that meant, it wasn't her concern. Her mission was simply to arrange a meeting between the investors and their chosen driver. The rest would be someone else's problem. Badger looked at his watch again, and she found herself faintly annoyed that the prospect of a NASCAR job, not to mention her own elegant self, did not seem sufficient to hold his interest.
"I'm sorry," she said sweetly. "Am I keeping you from something?"
He looked uncomfortable.
"No, I'm real interested in what you have to say, ma'am. It's just that the body shop closes at 5, and I need to get there before Jesse goes home."
"Body shop? You mean like car repair?"
He nodded unhappily.
"Yeah, only it's not a car I'm taking in, it's a turtle."
Susie frowned.
"I'm sorry, I'm not very familiar with racing terms. What is a turtle?"
Badger gave this question serious consideration.
"Well," he said at last, "it's sort of like a lizard, but with a hard shell."
"An actual turtle?"
"Uh-huh. This one is about so big."
He positioned his hands to indicate something the size of a garbage can lid.
"Do you mean that you are taking a live turtle to a car repair shop?"
She was sidetracked in spite of herself.
"Have to," said Badger, as solemnly as ever. "I found it in the lake just as I was putting in to come here. Motorboat propeller had tore up his shell pretty bad, so I hauled him in and put him in the truck. I figured me and Jesse could fix him."
Susie stared.
"How?"
"Fiberglass. You know how to apply fiberglass for repair work? No? Well, it comes in a close-woven mat, and you just mix it with resin and paint it onto the split part of the shell, smooth it down with a roller, maybe sand it down after it dries, and it'll just knit that shell right back up into one piece. Only take a couple of hours, I reckon."
She was gazing into those drowned eyes again in bewildered fascination.
"So, you were going to spend the evening saving the life of an injured turtle?"
"Uh-huh."
He glanced away.
"Lorraine, do you have any lettuce you were going to throw away? Figure he might get hungry while we're waiting for the stuff to harden."
Like one who is hypnotized yet still awake, Susie saw her hand place itself on the young man's arm, and she heard herself say, "Do you need any help? I could come with you, maybe bring you some dinner while you're working."
"Well, thank you," said Badger, "but I expect you ought to be getting back to Atlanta before it starts getting dark. The roads aren't too well marked up here, but thank you for coming, and you can tell those folks I'd be glad to talk to them about driving."
He stopped just long enough to accept a plate full of chopped lettuce from Lorraine, then he was gone. Susie stared for a few moments at the door to the cafe, and then, still dazed, she shook a packet of Sweet'n'Low into her empty coffee cup and tried to drink it.
From behind the counter, Lorraine was watching her with a pitying smile. Finally, Susie murmured,
"But he's so sweet. From what you said, I thought he'd be some kind of leering, sex-crazed playboy."
Lorraine shook her head sadly. "Oh no, hon. You got the wrong end of the stick. Badger ain't the motorboat. He's the turtle."
Chapter 2. Drive My Car. Engine Noise, your online source for NASCAR news and views. Wonder Women? Engine Noise is hearing that a new team is being formed in NASCAR. With a twist, the crew chief and pit crew will all be female. An all-woman group of investors, spearheaded by chemical heiress Christine Berenson, is supposed to be putting together this ladies' team for NASCAR Cup racing with the intention of running a full season beginning next year. The wheelman will be a guy, though, because they need a veteran cup driver to add some experience to this novice team. Who will they choose as their token man? Berenson isn't ready to announce yet, and since EN's prognostication skills are rusty, we might miss the mark. So to ward off all your questions, we say, don't badger us for an answer. Number 30. Christine Berenson tapped her computer screen with one perfectly manicured nail.
"That last bit is in code somehow, isn't it?" she asked her visitor.
The big man leaned across the desk to read the Engine Noise article with its vastly premature, yet accurate assessment of the new NASCAR team. Then he settled back in the leather visitor's chair with an enigmatic smile.
"Of course it is." In that last sentence, the writer managed to work in the names of Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, and Ward Burton, all veteran drivers who might conceivably be lured back into cup racing if the right deal came along. Oh, and Badger Jenkins, of course. So they hedged their bets a little on who the driver would be, but they did come up with the right answer. They usually do.
She frowned. How did they find out these things? Her visitor shrugged, seemingly unperturbed by this security leak. In the world of motorsports, the man was a cross between a rock star and the Secretary of State. He knew everything and everyone, and, in another sphere of influence, he had been an acquaintance of Christine Berenson for 20 years. They had served on several advisory boards together and had exchanged pleasantries at the usual charity events that pass for a social life among the moneyed classes. The man's current role was that of a friendly expert, giving her advice out of the goodness of his heart because of their long-standing association. She thought of him as the big wheel.
"I wouldn't worry about it, Christine," he said.
"Engine Noise just reports rumors, which means that word about your team has already leaked out from somewhere. At least this way you know that the news is in the wind. And it isn't such a worrying disclosure after all, is it? You were planning to announce it soon anyhow."
"But how did they know?"
He shrugged.
"People call in tips to the website just for the hell of it, I guess. The people at Engine Noise talk to hauler drivers, waitresses, shop people. You've been looking for a place around Mooresville to locate your operation, aren't you? Maybe your real estate agent blabbed. Or someone could have overheard your dinner conversation in a restaurant. But it will be common knowledge soon enough, once your NASCAR application is formally approved. So why fret about it?"
Christine sighed. "NASCAR application. You have to apply to join this sport, as if it were a country club."
"It is, in a way. NASCAR is the only privately owned sport in the world. You should be fine, though.
They are chiefly interested in whether you intend to play by the rules and whether you can afford to compete. I don't think there's any question of that.
No, I suppose not, said Christine. But it is a rather unsettling feeling to know that one is being watched.
The man laughed. Get used to it, then. NASCAR is such a small world that you can dial a wrong number and still talk. But by and large, they're nice people, and if you need any advice, most of them will be glad to help you.
Will they give me recommendations? Our biggest problem is that we don't know anybody. How do we find mechanics and fabricators and all the rest of the people we need?
He raised his eyebrows. Mechanics and fabricators? All female?
That won't be possible, she said, with the air of someone rehearsing a soundbite. Behind the scenes, we need good, qualified people, regardless of who they are. I just need to know how to find them.
Then hire a team manager who does know the sport, Christine, and then trust that team manager's judgment. The less you meddle, the better, I'd say, until you get a better sense of what you're doing. And don't expect to do a lot of winning in your first year of competition. It will take a while for all the components to gel, you know.
But surely, if we hire top-notch people...
Experience counts, he reminded her.
You specified an all-female pit crew. That will put you a few laps short on experience right there. They'll learn soon enough, I expect, but you mustn't expect too much too soon.
What if the sponsors get impatient?
He considered the point.
Winning is pleasant, he conceded. But all in all, most sponsors would rather have a personable driver who is popular with the fans than an obnoxious winner who endears himself to no one. Ideally, what you want is a handsome, nice guy who wins.
Jeff Gordon.
He smiled. She was learning fast.
Exactly. If you could afford him, which you cannot.
She sighed. It would take the economy of a third world country to afford him. Imagine our surprise when we discovered that.
It's not like hiring a pilot, you know, Christine. You're not hiring a high-speed chauffeur. There's a lot more involved in the job than just driving the car. Your driver is a brand, an image. He can attract sponsors or scare them off. But tell me, why Badger Jenkins?
Christine stared.
Have you ever seen him?
He laughed.
Almost all of him, he said dryly. I once saw him change into his fire suit before a race. I can't say that the sight of any of them in skivvies does much for my blood pressure, but you might be favorably impressed.
She thought it best to ignore that remark.
Badger is certainly personable, photogenic. People seem to like him. To us, he seemed an obvious choice.
Her NASCAR mentor was silent for so long that she thought he wasn't going to answer, but at last he said,
"You know, Badger has had a hiatus in his career. Spent some time between rides, which isn't a usual thing. Didn't you ask yourself why that was?"
"No. We thought we were lucky to have a chance to hire him. I suppose we chalked it up to fate. But since you brought it up, tell me, why was he available?"
He hesitated.
"Well, Badger is a nice young man."
"Oh, God. What is it? Drugs? Alcohol? Girl Scouts? Boy Scouts?"
"None of the above, Christine. The word around the garage is that he's just a little laid back, that's all."
"A race car driver? Laid back?
You mean he loses? He won't take chances?
Not at all. On the track, he is a mad dog. He'll try to put that car in places I wouldn't try to fit a shoehorn. Oh, he's brave enough, all right. Except that I'm not sure it really counts as brave if you're so deep in denial that you think death is something that only happens to other people.
Never mind that. You admit he's a good driver. I know for a fact that he's gorgeous. So, what's the matter with him?
The big wheel sighed.
Nothing is the matter with him, at least not by the standards of the old days of racing. But times change. Badger is an old-style cup driver, southern, fearless, and likable. If he had been around in the era of Cale Yarborough and Junior Johnson, he'd have been a champion, but now...
Now?
He just wants to race. He thinks that's what his job is. Drive the car. Then he'd like to go home. He doesn't work in the textile mill like some of the old-timers did on weekdays, but he definitely thinks he can have another life besides cup racing. And he can't.
He can't?
Not in this day and age, Christine. He has to live and breathe racing. The team is his family. The job is his life. When he isn't involved in the mechanics of racing, he ought to be given interviews, doing charity work, filming commercials, and generally keeping himself on the map of celebrity. Dating a movie star would be a nice touch.
She shuddered. You make it sound as if we bought him instead of just hiring him to race on Sundays. The big wheel considered it.
We pay them a lot of money, he said at last. And it isn't forever, you know. The career of an athlete isn't terribly long in most cases. 20 years if he's lucky. Anyhow, if he doesn't want the job on those terms, there's 10,000 other guys who would crawl over broken glass to get it. You'd be wise not to let him forget that.
Thanks. I'll do my best. But he is a good driver, right?
He's a natural. Now it's up to you to help him win.
And how do I manage that?
Hire the best people you can find. Pay them enough to keep them. Don't meddle too much. Let them know you appreciate them and give them the wherewithal to win.
She smiled. As simple as that, huh?
He shrugged. Well, it's like diet and exercise. Everybody knows how to do it. The question is, can you make yourself do what it takes, even when it isn't easy?
I guess I'll find out, she said.
Ralph Earnhardt, Marvin Panch, Benny Parsons, Bobby Allison. She had it now. Julie Carmichael stuffed the scrap of newspaper back into the pocket of her jeans. She wondered how other people remembered phone numbers, or license plates, street addresses. It was the only advantage she could think of to her unconventional upbringing. Every number to her was a NASCAR name and face, which meant that she seldom forgot a number or transposed the digits. The difference between 12 and 21 was Ryan Newman versus Ricky Rudd. You weren't likely to mix up those two. Her skill at remembering numbers was certainly useful, but it didn't make up for the rest of her bleak childhood. She remembered all the Spam and pinto bean dinners, the smell of motor oil and gasoline that pervaded the small frame house and never quite went away. The bill collectors she'd been sent to the door to deal with, in hopes that a wide-eyed little girl could convince them to leave. Those were hard times, but Daddy always said they would get better. Prosperity was just around the next turn in the track, he used to say. Only it wasn't.
She had been an only child back in Rowan County, but she hadn't felt like one. The real child of the household had been Daddy's pride and joy, a hulking steel monster with a room of its own, the garage. For as long as Julie could remember, that car, or one of its predecessors, had taken precedence over her. All the spare time that Daddy could steal from his day job went into his relationship with that car, tinkering with it, racing it, repairing it. The car always got fed, got new shoes, got doctored, whether she did or not. Like some revered male heir to whom its parents sacrificed everything in hopes that it would someday support them, the car was catered to, and the family often went without so that the monster's needs could be met. The car was their hope of prosperity. That had been the plan, certainly. That hunk of steel and plastic was supposed to win races and, ultimately, carry them all away to some happily ever after beyond Victory Lane, and from there onto bigger tracks and grander rides, until finally they'd have a fancy house and enough money so that everybody could have new shoes and a second helping of meat. Well, it hadn't worked like that. Despite all the sacrifices, Big Brother the car had never lived up to its promise, and Daddy had died too young to make it work or to wise up and try to do something else with his life. Julie decided that it was up to her to even the score between humans and machines, and she figured that cars owed her something to make up for the lousy childhood she'd had. Early on, she had worked out a strategy to succeed. She treated herself like a car. She stayed as pretty as she could, because paint schemes matter, and she made excellent grades in high school to streamline her path to greater things. She stayed away from roughneck boys, who would have constituted a detour in her life plan, and finally, she won a scholarship to Virginia Tech, where she'd studied automotive engineering with a fierce determination that allowed her no time for socializing or extracurricular activities. She graduated from Tech with highest honors because she had pursued car knowledge like a bounty hunter going after a fugitive, which, in a way, she was. After graduation, she had her pick of job offers. But instead of heading for a research and development job with one of the big car manufacturers, she had chosen to devote her talents to NASCAR. Her advisor's jaw had dropped when she told him. "NASCAR, Julie?" he'd said. "How could you possibly choose that over an industry job?" She'd smiled and said that she thought it might be an adventure, which was true. Industry jobs would always be there, but she thought she'd like to try stock car racing first. "Daddy would have been proud," she'd said primly, speaking of her family's racing tradition with a nostalgic pride she did not feel. She still had nightmares about standing on the roof of an old sedan with a stopwatch in her hand, ready to time a car that hurtled past her at breakneck speed. She could still feel the dust in her throat and the chill of the night air on her bare legs. Carmichael. Her father's folks had been of Irish descent. Maybe, in an earlier time, they would have been horse crazy instead of obsessed with cars. Maybe this obsession with speed was bred in the bone. Sometimes she could feel it too. But mostly she felt the rage of the slighted child toward the hated favorite. Now, though, she would be in charge. We got him. Christine Berenson held up the photo in front of her as if it were a mirror. So this is Badger Jenkins. As always, with Christine Berenson, The professional reaction came before the personal one. She acknowledged that whatever his shortcomings educationally and socially, the camera obviously loved Badger Jenkins. Definitely an asset in a world where money buys speed, because sponsors provide the money. Win or lose, a pretty boy in the driver's seat could bring in corporate sponsors, not to mention selling a million t-shirts, coffee mugs, and other assorted ritual items to his besotted admirers. Her advisor said that Badger Jenkins was a good driver, a seat-of-the-pants driver, all nerves and instinct, but she was more pleased that the other end of him was marketable, for business reasons. Well, mostly for business reasons. The face that looked back at her from the photo looked nothing like hers. It was a strong, masculine face that seemed composed of sharp edges, prominent cheekbones, a blade of a nose, a jutting jaw. Even the brown eyes were piercing. It wasn't an angry face, though. Focused, perhaps, determined. Struggling to have a thought, Christine told herself with a wry smile, fighting the attraction of that face. He was, after all, just a race car driver. Imagine trying to make him sit through an opera. She sighed. If their genders were reversed, she could keep him as a pet, and no one would think twice about it. But women were denied that luxury. They were expected to marry someone even more powerful than themselves, and that usually meant someone older and more shark-like. This little one-trick pony would probably end his career in half a dozen years, with $2 million in the bank and 4 concussions, and think himself both rich and lucky. No, you couldn't ally yourself with him on any formal basis. Idly, she ran her forefinger along the perfect jawline in the photo. But he was undeniably handsome, in the same way that a thoroughbred or a harrier jet is beautiful. Perfection of design with no conscious desire to please. The man was looking away from the camera, absorbed in some private reverie of his own, indifferent to the effect those perfect features might have on the observer. He was too busy being himself to care what anybody thought about him. Exactly like a stallion. That's what he reminded her of. Her first horse. That little bundle of nerves that was so beautiful and so much stronger than she was. She had to learn, by sheer force of will, to get the better of him by outthinking him. It was a lesson that had served her well, and one worth remembering now. This man looked as if he didn't care what anyone thought about him, as long as he could do whatever it was he was determined to do. Win races, she supposed. She wondered what it would feel like to be so unencumbered of the feelings of others. Certainly, she had never known such self-possession. As far back as she could remember, the pressure had been there to be pretty, to be smart, to be pleasing to others. First, Mummy had instilled in her the message that people only liked pretty girls, slender girls, smiling girls. And if she had doubted the truth of those early lessons, then half a dozen years of adolescence would have shown her the light. Because to be an ugly duckling in the world of private schools and debutante parties was to experience hell on earth. The poor, chubby, frizzy-haired beast on her hall had swallowed a bottle of aspirin, had her stomach pumped, and then went away forever, giggling with relief and joy. What would it feel like to exercise just because you enjoyed it, rather than in social self-defense? To befriend people because they were interesting and not because they were useful? To live without second-guessing yourself every waking moment? One might as well ask a thoroughbred. Certainly, this pretty boy was not up to philosophical discussions, but that was all right. She would do the thinking for the team, and she would see that he was treated well and kept happy. Just as she would have looked after a thoroughbred had the other form of racing appealed to her instead. "But why would you want to invest in a stock car?" Tate had asked her in mild bewilderment, as if she'd ordered oysters in May. She had given him a vague smile and a little shrug, trying to formulate a polite response. It wasn't as if he actually cared. It was, after all, her money. "I don't know," she said. "Horses are so passé, I suppose." He nodded, not really interested in anything she did, but as unfailingly polite as six generations of inbreeding could possibly make him.
"Yes, one does feel that the sport is somewhat quaint in this age of lasers and space shuttles."
She nodded. They vaguely knew of people in Northern Virginia who kept polo teams, and certainly indie racing was fashionably daring in their social circle. But she rather fancied the idea of cars that looked like actual street vehicles and the reverse snob appeal of stock car racing. NASCAR was indeed a millionaire sport, even if few people realized that fact. It was different. Christine liked being different, as long as she did not incur any social punishment for it. Stock car racing promised not to be boring. The other women with whom she had formed this venture all sounded so idealistic, talking about opportunities for women and automotive safety research, and she had murmured agreement with all these lofty goals. But really, her motives were much more basic than that. And it was her money. Tate, making a noble effort to keep the conversational ball rolling, said,
"Well, I suppose cars are easier to repair than horses."
She nodded, as if this had been a consideration, then, amusing herself by coming as close to the truth as she dared, Christine had said, "And after all, darling, what is the point of owning a horse if you can't ride it?" Badger Jenkins. Oh, yes.
Christine Berenson looked at the stack of reports on her desk and sighed. Who knew that starting a sports venture could be so, well, corporate? She supposed that it made sense, really. Everyone knew that NASCAR was a multi-billion dollar business, the only family-owned sport in the world. But somehow the idea of investing in a form of entertainment obscured the fact that it was simply a business like anything else. With a grimace, she pictured the operators of the Roman Colosseum toting up their expenses for lion upkeep and arena personnel against the projected gate receipts of the games. First, they'd had to line up sponsors, because you couldn't even play the game without $20 million or so to bankroll the operation. It was amazing how many months of planning and meeting and schmoozing had to take place before the gentleman could start his engine. The race may go at 180 miles per hour, but the preliminary phase went at a snail's pace. So much to plan and negotiate. Find a suitable property to use as a race shop. They had decided to rent one in the vicinity of Mooresville rather than go to the extra expense of new construction because, after all, one never knew whether the venture would turn out to be successful or not. Most of the race shops were within hailing distance of Mooresville anyhow, which meant that finding some suitable but vacant garage space was a feasible plan, and the personnel to run the operation would also be available locally. She sighed, looking at the morass of papers on her desk, stacks of job applications and resumes and letters of recommendation. Who knew how many people were required to run even a one-car racing team? She marveled at the figures before her. Anyone who thought that stock car racing was one man driving one car was decades out of the loop. The venture was beginning to remind her of the space program. A few people going up in high-tech machines, backed by a small army of engineers and technicians on the ground. Same with racing, apparently. The race shop, once established and outfitted, would house dozens of support personnel who would never even go to the speedways themselves. These shop dogs built the cars, refurbished old or damaged ones, engineered the motors, tinkered with body design to gain the best advantage for a given track, and did a dozen other things to ensure that the driver had the best car the team could afford to field. Engineers, fabricators, mechanics, secretaries, janitors, publicists. It added up to a lot of salaries. Who knew? She had been vaguely aware of the need for a pit crew for the race itself. People to change tires and put fuel in the car. But this behind-the-scenes infrastructure of personnel had taken her by surprise, although she didn't know why it should have. Everything was complex these days. How naive they had been back when they thought that securing the services of Badger Jenkins was the answer to all their problems. Now she sometimes found herself thinking that he hardly mattered at all. Certainly his talent could not compensate for poor engineering, bad equipment, or a lack of research and development. That face would sell a lot of t-shirts, though. And it ought to lure in a fair number of sponsors that wanted a good-looking athlete to personify their products. Every day she was finding out that she needed answers to questions that had never even occurred to her when the project began. Fortunately, she had seasoned advisors on board to answer those questions, but still, it gave her pause to think of how little they had known about the logistics of it all when they began. There were questions that had never even occurred to them at the outset. How does the pit crew get to far-flung racetracks like Sonoma or Phoenix or New Hampshire? And most of the races these days were well beyond driving distance from the greater Charlotte area, home of the majority of race teams. Where do you house them for race weekends, and who feeds them? None of these minor problems of logistics had occurred to them when they began the team, but little by little, practicality had intruded upon the daydream of owning a human racehorse. And one by one, questions were asked and answered, often by courtly old gentlemen who seemed within a syllable of using the term little lady in their discourse. But, however antiquated the men's worldviews, their advice had been eminently practical, and little by little the answers fell into place, so that now, many months later, they could actually say that the team existed, that it was housed in adequate, if not luxurious, quarters in Cabarrus County, and that it was staffed by competent professional engineers, mechanics, and other support persons necessary to the running of a race team. This behind-the-scenes crew was, necessarily, predominantly male. This gender bias was unfortunate but essential, Christine thought with a sigh. Fielding an all-female team sounded charming and democratic on the face of it, but the truth was, one simply could not fill all the behind-the-scenes technical positions with women. Racing had for too long been an all-male domain, so that most of the current expertise, the hands-on experience of stock car racing, resided in male brains, and the fact was that one simply could not do without them. After a brief meeting and a careful examination of the cold, hard facts, the investors agreed that there was no choice in the matter. The behind-the-scenes personnel would have to be mostly male, and that's all there was to it. But the pit crew was the most visible part of the operation anyhow, aside from the driver, and in that area, they did have an element of choice. She had called a meeting of her fellow investors to, the cliché made her smile, bring them up to speed. Technically, they were owners too, but she was really the one in charge. Some of them just chipped in their money for a lark, believing that her venture was a good investment, and certainly were able to afford the loss if it wasn't. It was fun. A couple of the others were interested in the sport as fans, but they had promised to give her a free hand in the running of the team. But they enjoyed getting together hearing about her adventures in this brave new world. Sometimes she felt like the star of a private reality show for millionaires, Survivor, NASCAR. But she didn't mind entertaining them, considering how much money they'd entrusted her with. And if she learned the sport well, and if luck was on her side, then in a little while, nobody would be laughing at her. That was the important part of the enterprise. Badger was just a side bet with herself, the icing on the cake. "I'm working on assembling a pit crew," Christine told the assembled gathering. "How hard can that be? Change the tires, put gas in the car, clean the windshield." One of the younger women raised her hand. "Actually, Christine, I read that race car windshields are tear-off sheets of..." "I know," said Christine through clenched teeth. After all these months and all this work, how could they think she wouldn't know that? She forced a smile. "I was simply making a point. Thank you, Faye. But the premise is sound. Anyone of reasonable strength and agility can be trained to perform those tasks in a relatively short time. Unlike the intricacies of engineering and mechanics, which take years of study and experience. Fortunately, people at the race and television viewers will see the pit crew and not the shop personnel. So, in accordance with our intended goal, to the casual observer, the team will still look all female." "Well, except for Badger," said Diane Hodges, the former Miss Texas who had married into oil. "He could make my toes curl through a locked door." A large framed poster of Badger Jenkins in his fire suit hung on the wall of the office. With one accord, the investors turned to study it. One or two smiled approvingly, and one of them said, "He reminds me of my grandson."
"Perhaps we should have tried harder to find a female race car driver," said the investor from Winnetka. "There's that girl at Indy."
"We can't afford her," Christine replied, with the assurance of one who has had this argument so many times that her response was a soundbite. "There are half a dozen women in the lower echelons of stock car racing as well, but either they are under contract to one of the big teams and development programs, or they are out of our price range, or both."
"I like Badger just fine," said Miss Texas.
"I'm sure that a lot of women will agree with you," said Christine. "That bodes well for our recruiting of new secondary sponsors. Companies who sell primarily to women will want an image that appeals to them."
"Oh, honey, he does."
"And remember that souvenir merchandising is a significant source of income in motorsports. Pretty faces sell t-shirts, hats, coffee mugs. The potential is huge. Even if he loses, we'll still win.
But of course, we want to win."
Chapter 3. Hail to the Chief. Grace Buell Hoskins Tuggle hoped that the job interview wasn't going to include lunch. Not that she minded a free meal, but from the looks of the ladies on the interview committee, every one of them about two ribs short of a shadow, she figured their idea of a noonday meal would be a lettuce leaf and an X-lax pill. They were skinny enough to be driver's wives for sure, but they looked a little too steely-eyed and old money for that. Now, back in the old days, when Daddy had been racing, the wives were whoever the racers had happened to marry, back when they started out working in the factory or wherever, and their lined faces and plump bodies testified to a lifetime of hard work, starchy food, and infinite patience with race-crazed husbands. Grace, who was pleased that her initials also stood for grievous bodily harm, but who preferred simply to be known as Tuggle, did not hold with fad diets and plastic surgery. In her opinion, if being a willowy size 2 got you a race car driver for a husband, then they ought to put warning labels on SlimFast. Wheelmen, lawn jockeys with 800 horsepower egos.
Fortunately, she was past the age to confuse foolhardy with sexy, which was just as well, because no driver worth his salt would listen to a pretty girl giving him orders over the headset anyhow. They'd listen to her, though. If they had any sense, they would. Her daddy had been a force to be reckoned with on the racing circuit, back in the days when North Carolina was the hub of the world. Hickory, Asheville, Wilkesboro, Winston-Salem. She often said that her blood type was high test. And then there were her two husbands, the driving one from her wild younger days, who had put her heart so far into the wall that she thought she'd never get over him. Well, she hadn't really. That was the truth of it. But at least she had learned from that experience that restrictor plates were not a bad thing for the human heart. Her second husband, Doyle, was a mechanic, and she claimed that she'd married him for entertainment. He didn't take your breath away like the first one did, but he didn't make you want to put a hose to the exhaust pipe either, so she reckoned it evened out. Less joy, less sorrow. That's what getting older mostly meant anyhow. Drivers, like tigers. A lot of fun to look at, maybe even okay for a brief, wary encounter. But try to hold on to one and he will rip you to shreds. Well, maybe times had changed with all these West Coast pretty boys coming into the sport. But Tuggle didn't think so, and she rejoiced in the fact that she was too old to care. She wondered if she ought to offer the benefit of her wisdom to this charmed circle of designer-clad ladies, but she decided against it. They were too old to care, too, whether they knew it or not. And maybe they were into the sport for philosophical reasons. An all-woman team? Well, whatever kept the sponsors happy. She assumed an expression of polite interest, which on her bulldog features looked like a double dog dare, as she waited for the questioning to commence. The regal one they called Christine began by saying, "Perhaps you could tell us a little bit about yourself, Grace." Tuggle winced at the sound of her given name, sounding like a sermon title in the precise diction of this high-maintenance woman.
"It's Tuggle, if it's all the same to you," she corrected her. "As for my qualifications, my daddy ran dirt track and late model stocks around the region, wherever he could afford to go and still keep his day job. Back then, family was about the only pit crew you could afford, so he trained me and my brothers early on."
As if in answer to an unspoken question, she added,
"They're dead now."
She kept her voice steady. Well, mostly steady. Willing herself not to think about little Gary, dead in a rice paddy in Vietnam, and Cole, the daredevil, hitting the wall at Hickory in those days before fuel cells, when the word fire stuck in your throat.
"And I believe you raced yourself at one time."
She nodded.
"They used to have powder puff derbies, as they called them. Good for attracting a crowd to the track on off nights. Daddy said I was almost as good as Cole, but of course I quit that foolishness once I grew up. Keeping a marriage going is a darn sight harder than winning an old stock car race."
"Times have changed since those days," said one of the younger women in a not-from-around-here accent. "NASCAR is rocket science now. What makes you think you could manage a team in a sport dominated by engineers?"
"Well, I reckon you'll have engineers," said Tuggle. "Strategy hasn't changed. Maybe the cars are better now, and NASCAR keeps adding rules as fast as folks can think up ways around them, but it's still the same old sport it used to be."
"Now, we realize that our aim of having an all-women team is a bit unusual."
Tuggle shrugged.
"Well, it's not traditional, of course. Back in my day, the old-time drivers had a saying, no tits in the pits. But times do change, don't they?"
She flashed a wolfish smile at the circle of frozen faces.
Times do indeed change, murmured Christine. We consulted various experts, you know, fitness instructors, physicians, engineers, and they seem to think that there's no reason a female pit crew couldn't do the job, providing that they were carefully chosen and properly trained.
Likely as not, Tuggle agreed. Women came in all shapes and sizes, especially in these exercise-crazed days. She'd known a few gals who could bench-press tractors. Find some of them, and there wouldn't be a problem.
Of course, we will need someone to oversee the operation. I understand that it is customary to have a team manager and a crew chief, but we see no reason why a competent person couldn't do both those things as one job. What do you think?
Tuggle thought she'd have to have had more than one Bloody Mary for breakfast to tell this group of wine and cheese ladies what she thought about anything. She needed the job, and if that meant agreeing to use St. Christopher's medals for hubcaps, she'd go along with it to keep the team owners happy.
And we are already in negotiations with a driver. This one. With a proprietary smirk, Christine Berenson slid an 8x10 photo out of a folder and passed it across the desk. Tuggle contemplated the picture of Badger Jenkins, who was looking smolderingly at the camera, his legs spread far enough apart for a prostate exam. She snorted, unimpressed.
Yeah, I know Badger, she said. He's all right. Good seat of the pants driver.
Two of the investors glanced at each other, lips twitching. We noticed that, one of them said. Tuggle scowled. She didn't hold with people who treated drivers like cat toys, or with drivers treating fans like that, for that matter.
Seat of the pants means a driver who can react quickly and handle things by instinct, whatever happens out there. A natural.
She glanced again at the photo.
I can see how you might misinterpret that phrase, though, with this to go by. That boy keeps sitting like that, he's gonna get himself arrested.
For indecent exposure?
For false advertising.
The investors glanced at one another and then wisely decided not to pursue this line of questioning. So, would you be comfortable working with Badger Jenkins? She considered it, knowing that the bosses wanted only a yes-no answer from her. What they really wanted was a yes answer as quickly as possible, but it wasn't that simple. Like any cup driver, Badger had his good points and his bad points. The question was whether he was good enough to make putting up with the rest worthwhile, and, more importantly, whether the team could get anybody better who was likely to be less trouble. On the whole, she thought that they couldn't. Would she be comfortable working with Badger? Well, he was a sweet boy, no meanness in him, as far as she could see. He could be stubborn, and he could show temper, but he wouldn't be a race car driver if that weren't the case. She did know Badger.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.